Okay, so we already have seen different kind of filters before that. Now the next topic, which is known as oscillator. Now, what is an oscillator? I already have discussed maybe in brief previously when I was discussing the feedback. So let us start with a normal feedback circuit itself and see what oscillator is actually mean. So if you see the feedback circuit here, so it's a normal feedback circuit, right? So your transfer function in this case would be the output by input, which is nothing but As divided by 1 plus As beta s. Now if you remember previously, in such a situation I considered beta to be constant. Okay, so previously the beta was constant, but in this case your beta is not exactly constant, it's frequency dependent. I put s, so beta j omega. Beta s means beta j omega. So in this case it's not exactly constant, it's a function of frequency. And what does that mean? That means that in your feedback network, probably now you will find frequency dependent components like capacitor and inductor. Previously, in case of amplifiers, we wanted this beta to be constant, but this time we are putting inductor and capacitor in the feedback network, which makes it frequency dependent. Now, if you look at this transfer function, then what will be your loop gain? Your loop gain is As beta s. Say if you put 1 plus A beta, that is As beta is equal to 0, then your transfer function becomes infinite. What does that mean? Say for the sake of argument, I said 1 plus A beta is equal to 0. That means the denominator becomes 0. Now the transfer function becomes infinite. What does that mean? That means your output by input equal to infinite. That means even if your input is 0, you are getting some sort of finite output. Your input is 0, you are getting some output, and this is the condition that is known as oscillator. You actually do not put a typical input to this system, but you get certain amount of output, and this is what the oscillator is all about. Okay, so what does this lead to? It leads to that A beta should be equal to minus 1. That means your loop gain should be minus 1. So this is one condition for an oscillator. Now regarding this, Barkhausen has given some criteria for the oscillator to be sustainable. So what was that criteria? In fact, if I go back to the circuit, I think once I have said that for a condition, if you put a positive feedback or negative feedback, this, what is a positive feedback? When your feedback thing is mixing with your input and actually adding to the input is known as a positive feedback. In such a situation, what happens? If something is coming from the output side and increasing the input, then your output will again increase. Again, that portion of that output will come and again will add to the input, then your output will further increase. So it will be a continuous process. So we call this a growing system. Okay, so once I told, in such a growing system we can actually create an oscillator. Now we will see what happens. Now regarding this, Barkhausen given a criteria wherein he said that the loop gain that we have just calculated, the magnitude of the loop gain should be 1 and the phase of that loop gain should be minus 180 degree. Okay, if you look at this, if this is an amplifier or if this is a transistor, you get minus 80 degree from here, we already have seen in case of amplifier that the output is always 180 degree. There is a phase shift of 180 degree. So you get a minus 180 degree here. Now you want another minus 180 degree here. So in total, it is 360 degree, which is nothing but 0 degree. So your feedback is essentially a positive feedback and it will keep on adding your input, which will create the situation that I just have said, right? So this is a criteria for an oscillator, that the phase shift of your this loop side should be 180 degree. Anyways, you are getting 180 degree phase shift from the amplifier, another 180 degree you are adding. So total will be 360 degree, or you can say this is the signal, the feedback signal is in phase with the input, and the real part or the magnitude of this transfer function should be 1. Or you can say that the magnitude of this transfer function you can consider minus 1 and the phase will be 0. This is also possible, because if your magnitude is minus 1, you already have 180 degree phase shift, and then your magnitude is becoming minus 1. So automatically you are actually sending the signal in phase with the input. So both the cases are more or less similar. Okay. So any of these case will lead to an oscillator. So this is known as Barkhausen criteria. So here I have just summarized the thing that I have just said. So phase shift through amplifier and feedback network must become 360 degree. That means amplifier is giving 180 degree, and in the feedback side you are getting another 180 degree. So in total you are getting 360 degree. This is exactly what is said here, and the magnitude should be 1. Okay. Now let us see a very simple oscillator, which is known as phase shift oscillator, wherein you use RC network in the feedback. I just said that we now will use a capacitor or inductor in the feedback side, so that it becomes a frequency dependent, right? Now if you have RC network in the feedback side, you can adjust the values of RCs in such a way so that you get an 180 degree phase shift over here. Now how do you tune the phase of an RC network? So it's simple, right? The total impedance associated with the capacitor is 1 by j omega c, and for R it is, for resistance it is R. So you get a combined effect of R and 1 by j omega c. So if you take the tan inverse of this y by x, you will get the phase. So that way it's simple network. Probably you have done it during your network analysis. So you will definitely get the phase shift using an RC network. Okay. Now you are getting 180 degree from the amplifier, and you can further induce another 180 degree phase shift in the feedback side. So total you will get 360 degree. That is, your job is done. Right. So our phase shift oscillator based on MOSFET is something like this, wherein you have RC networks in this side. The drop across this R is your feedback voltage, and this is of course a biasing part of a biasing circuit, so you can neglect this while we are considering the phase considering the oscillator case. And you have a load resistance RD. Okay. Now, as we used three different RC network, the total of this RC network will be 180 degree. Total phase shift from this RC network will be 180 degree. So each RC will provide you 180 divided by 3. That means 60 degree phase shift. So you tune the RC in such a way that each RC provides 60 degree phase shift. The corresponding equivalent circuit associated with this RC network is this, wherein this part is, we already have done so many times this thing. So this part is associated with the MOSFET, where this is the output resistance of the MOSFET, GMVGS is the current source, and RD is the load that you used in the biasing network. And then you have phase shift network connected to this, and the voltage across this final resistor is actually your VF, right? So you can consider this parallel R0 and RD as RD dash for the sake of simplicity, okay? So now you have a equivalent circuit associated with this phase shift oscillator based on MOSFET, okay? So the circuit now will look something like this, wherein you have considered this RD dash, and then you have taken I1, I2 and I3 as three loop currents in the corresponding loops, and then you solve KVL. It's very simple. If you do a KVL analysis, you will get three different equations related to I1, I2 and I3. This is your equation 1, equation 2 and equation 3, and finally you have VF is equal to I3 into R. So the current in this loop is I3, so I3 into R will be your VF. So in total you have four equations, okay? Now let us calculate the loop gain, which is AOL beta, right? So the loop gain is nothing but the feedback voltage divided by VGS. Do some calculations using these four equations. You have VF, you have VGS. Calculate the values of I1, I2 from these two equations. Put everything in this equation. You will find an expression which is equal to VF by VGS. So I have not done it. You can do it in your home. And you will find the expression will be something like this. Okay, it's a simple calculation. So I did not do this entire calculation. I just directly have written the expression associated with this VF by VGS. But if you solve these four equations, you will get an expression similar to this one. Okay. Now, we already have said in bar question criteria that for an oscillator case, the imaginary part should be equal to 0. So if you make this imaginary part equal to 0, that means 1 by omega RC cube minus 6 by omega RC equal to 0, you will find the frequency associated with this oscillator as omega 0, which is nothing but 1 by root 6 into RC, or RC into root 6, okay? And you also want the magnitude of this loop gain to be equal to 1. So if you do this and put this omega 0 value in here, because anyways this part you consider 0. If you put this omega 0 value over here, you will find the expression is minus gm rd dash divided by minus 29. That means gm rd dash by 29. Now I already have said, for oscillator, you want this to be equal to 1. Or you can say this should be at least greater than equal to 1. So if you consider the generalized case, so it should be equal to 1 or greater than equal to 1, which will lead to a GM R dash, RD dash equal to or greater than equal to 29. What does that mean? That means that your phase shift oscillator will act as an oscillator if your GM RD dash value is at least 29 or more than 29. Okay, so your gain of this entire circuit should be 29 or more than 29 in order to get an sustained oscillation. Then you will find your phase shift oscillator that I have just shown, this oscillator will act as a sustained oscillator. The oscillation will be sustained. So this is the condition. You will see in many circuit design case that people are considering this as 29 or more than 29, or they just put this value to be equal to 29 in order to design the phase shift oscillator. So now you have the reason behind this, why they do this. Okay, so from here you get the answer, the value 29, how it came. Okay, apart from this phase shift of oscillator, there is another very famous, or I would say a very popular oscillator, which is Weinbridge oscillator. In case of Weinbridge oscillator, what you do is you use RC network in the feedback side again, just like this circuit. Okay, so you put the RC network in non-inverting side and you have a feedback associated with that. So what is your open loop gain, which is 1 plus R2 by R1. Because it's a non-inverting case, so you have open loop gain is equal to 1 plus R2 by R1. And your beta in this case will be Zp divided by Zp plus Zs. This is the series RC network, that's why it is Zs. This is parallel RC network, that's why we call it Zp. So if you do this calculation and calculate the impedance associated with this Zp and Zs, because it is series, your Zs will be 1 plus RCS divided by SC, and your Zp will be R by 1 plus RCS. So these are simple calculations, you can do it very easily. Okay, now again you calculate the TS value, the loop gain value. If you do the loop gain value and start solving the expression, so you will find that your loop gain value is nothing but this expression. Now from where this came, I already have said, right? What is your loop gain? It is AOL beta. Your loop gain is AOL beta. So AOL is this 1 plus R2 by R1 and beta value is this one. So I just replace these values in this equation and then you find this expression. After that, you just simplify the expression and you will finally get an expression similar to this. So this is your TS value. Now again you apply the criteria that I just have explained. So your TJ omega will be 1 and real, and at the same time the imaginary part you can put it as equal to 0. So if you do this and do some simple mathematics, you will find that your omega 0 in this case is 1 by RC, right? And also if you take this into consideration, that is magnitude of TJ omega should be equal to 1. So your 1 will be this one, because you put the omega 0 value in here. If you put the omega 0 value in here, you will find your 1 plus R2 by R1 into 1 by 3 is equal to 1, which gives you R2 by R1 is equal to 2. I hope you understand. I repeat, because you have omega 0 is equal to 1 by RC, you put omega 0. So here if you put 1 by RC, this part will be gone, because anyways this part you have taken as equal to 0. So you have 1 plus R2 by R1 into 1 by 3. And then if you consider this one, you will see your R2 by R1 is equal to 2. This is for your sustained oscillation. This is the condition for you for sustained oscillation. Or you can say for start oscillation, it should be greater than or equal to 2. But it should be at least equal to 2, right? So in both the cases, you used RC network in the feedback and you got two different kind of oscillator. One is phase shift oscillator, another one is Weinbridge oscillator. So this name actually given after the name of Wein, who has made this or proposed this kind of circuit. Okay, that's why its name is Weinbridge circuit or Weinbridge oscillator. So this is all these two kind of oscillators are RC oscillators. However, if you see the values of omega 0, the frequency, previously it was 1 by RC root 6. In this case, it is 1 by RC. Now say you need a very high frequency operation. What you will do? You will reduce the value of R and reduce the value of C. Now reducing the value of C is still possible. You can go up to say femtofarad or something, but getting a very low value R is always difficult, because generally the low value resistors are metal plate resistors. So getting a low value resistor is difficult because their tolerance value is not very low. Generally it's more than 10%. When I say tolerance, that means if your resistance value is 100 and if it has a 10% tolerance, that means it may go or it may vary in between 90 and 110, which is still acceptable. But for a very low value resistor, the tolerance value is even higher. So you can't probably get a very nice oscillator from this RC circuit at very high frequency range. However, if you see the RC, just by varying the value of R and C, you can create n number of oscillators which oscillates at n number of frequencies. So it gives a better tuning. So you can tune those values very well. So how you can tune? You probably have heard of variable capacitance. So if you put in variable capacitance and change the capacitance, and you can also put in variable resistor as well. But I said resistor has a limitation in the lower range, but capacitance still can have a very low value. So if you have a variable capacitance, then you can actually tune that capacitance and get in very get a different kind of or get these oscillators which resonates at different or which operates at different frequency just by changing the value of C. And how can you put in variable capacitance? Just put in reverse bias diode. Reverse bias diodes are basically in capacitance. If you see the characteristics of a reverse bias diode, if it is C and if it is V, it's something like this, right? So if you increase the V, your C is actually changing. So you put a reverse bias diode, change just by changing the applied voltage, you can actually change the frequency where the oscillator is operating. So in this case, this will be known as voltage controlled oscillator. This type of oscillator will be voltage controlled oscillator, because just by changing the voltage, you are changing the frequency associated with that oscillator. Okay, so